Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City. I'm your host, Agent JZ. And the frequency of videos has dropped off recently for a couple of reasons. One of which is there's some work happening at our test cell. Let's go take a look at that.
Here we are at the test cell. It's gonna be a while before we can run another engine because we're breaking up the concrete to replace the stand upon which the engines run.
They are smashing things up. Well, here we go. This is our scrap bin. And that is our old test stand steel. Kind of sad, you know, a lot of history, a lot of engines tested on this thing. And it's just thrown away. But there's an indication. Let's see if I can stand on the junk here. There's an indication of how thick it is. I think it's 8-inch I-beam. It's pretty skookum, pretty decent. And there's a couple of them there. That the one closest to us was welded in later as an extra reinforcement. And they just chopped it up and threw it away. Look at that. There's one of the supports that went into the ground. Right next to an LP turbine shaft of a Rolls-Royce Spey, rusting in the rain. Yeah, this is where you get your souvenir turbine blades, people. Right there, in the junk. There's some more here. Wait, those are turbine inlet nozzles, or turbine stators, or turbine nozzles, we call them. Look at all the junk. That is structural steel. Gives you an idea of the strengthification of the thing that holds the engine to the earth. Yows. Okay, there's the machines that did the digging. There's the spoils, and we have a very special opportunity to see something kind of cool. Can you hear that echo? We're gonna take a look at the test cell with the floor ripped out. A lot of people have been asking over the years, geez, what keeps that engine from flying away? Well, there's the floor, the concrete, which is, I guess, I don't know, 6 inches thick, whatever, with some rubble underneath it. Oh, hang on, rubble underneath it. These are the 8, 2, 4, 6, 8 pilings made of pretty thick steel. Looks like 1/2 inch and maybe 8-inch diameter. Goes down, this is probably a 4-foot hole. Looks like about 1.5 meters, 1.25 meters, something like that. And this is the stuff that our stand was welded to. Looks like some daredevil was out there walking the plank, I tell ya! Wow, amazing. So, this is what we're gonna fill in with better, more compact stuff. I think we're gonna be replacing these pilings with something deeper and stronger. And that's what we're gonna test our engines on. We're not gonna see this very often. I've been here for close to 15 years. And I just thought I'd take this video because this is gonna all be covered up and rebuilt and we're never gonna see this again. That's very cool. Another one of the reasons is I've been involved for the past couple of weekends in racing the Jet City Turbines battle wagon. This is the machine. It's been rebuilt a couple times. It's essentially a 2001 SV650 that has GSXR 600 wheels and front forks from a 2009. And the brakes especially, the brakes are like an unfair advantage, but everything's fair. It's all legal, including the fact that it's been modified over the past year to be a 694 with Wiseco pistons and Carrillo rods. This is my favorite bike. You can tell that appearance is not the primary concern in our team. I mean, it looks decent, you know, but it's a race bike. It's not a prima donna showpiece that I drive around fast on racetracks. No, it's an actual race bike, and that's a different thing. It's a tool for going fast as I possibly can, and I'm a mid-pack finisher, let's be honest. It's racing for participation, not the world championship. But this is a really good bike. I really like it. It's got a Fox twin clicker on the back. Some modified, I still use the street shift pattern. Some people call me a weenie for doing that, but I never need to shift mid-corner at max lean. Hopefully you shouldn't be doing that. This is the view I try to expose by massive lean angle in the corners, sometimes. And as inspired by Uncle Doug, the vintage amp builder, the switches say on and not on. I love that. This is the view from the cockpit. I actually broke the windshield a couple years ago, and I discovered I liked it better. And Mission is a track where speeds don't get much more than 120 miles an hour for me anyway. So aerodynamics don't play that big of a role, and without the windscreen, I can mount a GoPro right there. And it moves with the handlebars. And we've got some footage of a lap or two of me that I just recorded 2 weeks ago in the 2019 round 1, 2, 3, and 4 doubleheader. So let's take a look at some of that. Okay, a couple things to remember about this footage. It's a track day, so we're supposed to be a little bit nice on the passes and things. And because I fall in the right on the borderline between fast racer and slow racer, they always put me in the slow racer category for practice times and track days. So I pass a lot of people. Most of the bikes in this practice session are Ninja 250s and Honda 300s, so it's not really fair to compare to them, although it's important to remember that those bikes have an advantage on the brakes going into corners, and they have an advantage in the corners. So if I can pass them on the brakes going into a corner or during a corner, I feel pretty good about that. But this has 70-ish horsepower. They've got about 30. So if I'm passing them coming out of a corner or in a straightaway, it doesn't really matter because it's not really a comparison of similar machinery. But there's a couple of ZX6s out there. I think I'll try to show the passes on the ZX6s, which makes me feel good because a ZX6 makes 90-ish horsepower as opposed to 70-ish. So if I can get the jump of them coming out of the corner or get them on the brakes going into the corner, that makes me feel like I'm doing okay. And also, being a track day racer practice session, not all the people you see are gonna be riding as hard as they can. They might be cruising around. What I was working on specifically was braking into corners, and so that's where I'm trying to catch people. Anyway, have a look at this. It's lots of fun. Trust me, my racing does not have as many passes of people in it because the competition is a lot tougher in an actual race. And like I said, I'm a mid-pack finisher at best, so enjoy this. Okay, here we are in the pits, going towards the hot pit, following, looks like a Ninja 250. And we come out here to wait usually for a green flag, and I think the green flag's out. So here we go, down the pit lane, which is basically just the entryway to the racetrack. I think I skip here. Yeah, I skip right to the transition line where now we gas it up. And who's in front of me? Who's in front of me? Most of the bikes in this class are going to be Ninja 250s. So let's see. Oh, that's the KTM 390. So this is a pretty good rider. But again, our bike has double the horsepower, so it's not a fair comparison. He's probably a much better rider than me. And this is turn two. This is one of my favorite corners. You want to make sure you don't hit the wall coming into turn two. And what I was working on is trying to get better on the brakes here. You'll see me making up a lot of ground on some people. But again, it's not a fair comparison because they may not be going as hard and they're also on smaller bikes. There's a Ninja 250 or possibly a CBR 250. So if I pass him coming out of the corner, that's not a fair comparison. I would only be happy if I got him through the corner because the light bikes, the little bikes, are much lighter and they are much better at taking the corners. I think this is an old FZ 400. An FZ 400? I'm not sure. Anyway, he's still getting used to his bike because he's cornering rather tentatively. And we'll be nice here and we'll wait and just go around the outside. Okay, so you can take a look at the tack here. The bike red line's at 10.5. I'm kind of taking it easy here. I don't know why. Usually I run it right to red line down the straightaway. And now I try to brake really hard and make up some time or distance on these people who may or may not be going their hardest. But I was practicing passing and braking. Here we are in turn two again. Leaning over far, but not far enough. Some of these riders are quite a bit better than me. I'm going to go by them because I just can't resist squirting by the power. I'll try to catch them here on the brakes. That is an inline four. That was a ZX6. And they must just be warming up because I know that rider and they're much better than what that looked like. This here. Let's see. What is it? Oh, that's an inline four as well. Okay, so this is an interesting pass because this person is not getting the best of their motorcycle, and maybe because they're still getting used to it or just warming up. But I'm coming into turn 7 here. 7, 8, 9 is probably my worst combination. 7 is a left-hander. Short straight to 8. They look at me there, so they're looking at me. I don't know why. Taking it kind of easy through here. And I'm trying to shoot up the inside, and you'll see what a four-cylinder does on the straightaway. They've got more power, so he shoots ahead, but he should be rocketing ahead. I don't know what's going on there. And then they're early on the brakes. I start braking at about brake marker 4, 3.5 during the races, 4 in practices. We'll count them next time around. That was turn 1. Here we come to turn 2 again. One of my favorites. Long and consistent. You want to get on early but not hit that wall when you run wide under power. Okay, trying to make up some ground here on another bike. We'll see what it is when we get closer. Again, this is a practice session and it makes you feel like a superhero because I'm in with a bunch of less powerful bikes and then a few bikes that have more power. So that is a looks like a Ninja 250 because of the small section, this narrow width of the rear tire. Pretty good rider. So he's hanging with me. I can't catch him in the corner, so he's at least as good as me, if not better. And I rage by him on the power, which I really should have waited and diced with him in the corners, but you can't resist. The practice sessions start to become like mini races. And I do have an advantage on power here, so that's cool. Coming onto the front straight, I skipped most of the length of the... Oh no, I skipped a whole lap there because I was just going around by myself. We were coming up on a bunch of other, smaller bikes. They do really well in the corners, and with a good rider on a 250 can lap this course faster than I can on my 650. To be honest, that's true. Okay, this is all right. You can hear if it's an inline four. I think this is. Yeah, the tire's pretty big. So, and it's got good power state. It's actually pulling away from me because I'm fully on it here. But this is how brakes win races, people. He started using his brakes before I did. And so he basically surrenders a position. And again, I can't tell you if he was going his 100% or not, but I was here. Turn four, this is probably not my best. Turn 5 is quite tight and also not my best. Most corners are not my best. This is 6, leading into 7. It's always shady here and so the light is a bit difficult to judge. It's not my favorite corner. I've been working on 7 and here comes 8. I want to try to touch your knee there. And 9. Here we go. Okay, so we've got the whole length of a straightaway until we get to some slower bikes. And so I'm practicing braking. Those orange squares on the side there, they've got numbers on them. The last one is 1, and they go out to 5. Ideally, for me, I shut off my throttle at 5 and start braking at 3.5. I'm probably shutting off at the imaginary 6 in this practice session and braking at 4. And so here, this is how we make up ground on the brakes. Wait a little bit longer and There's the accordion effect, but you're also going faster and you're braking later. You can gain 50 yards in somebody in one good straightaway braking session. Now we're coming up on them. This is good. These are smaller bikes, and if I'm gaining ground through the corners, that means that I'm half-ass here. I'm not too bad. I think I lost a bit there. I went wide in 5. 6 is better. And there they are. It looks like they're farther away. See if I can reel them in a bit. I'm no right at this point. This is 7. Going to 8. I know that when I come out of 9, I will be able to pass all these guys on power. So, again, that's an unfair advantage I have. But it happens to me all the time in racing when there's a 4-cylinder, a 600 or a 1000. Okay, so they're moving pretty good. These guys, I'll get this guy, I think, on the brakes. I'll have to wait till the next ones for the next guys. Oh, he's actually pretty good. This guy, he's probably a better rider than I am, and I've got 40 more horsepower, and he's going to fall to the power of the SV, but he's a good rider. He's cornering very well. Let's see if he gains ground on me here. He's a better rider than I am, I have to admit that. Okay, so I'll pass them on the inside. Now these guys, what have we got there? Another 250 class. Yep, I'm on somebody's GoPro there. Okay, and on the power. Can't really comment on his ability compared to mine because I have such an advantage in power here. Have to be fair. This guy is cornering pretty well. Okay, so I'm barely hanging with him in 5. Maybe losing a bit of ground on 6. So this person, they've got their act together. Going into 7. Oh, do I gain anything? Slightly. And that looks like, that does look like a 250. So that's a very good rider. On equal machinery, I would never see him. He would just walk away from me. But we do have an extra 40 horsepower here. So we go by. And we go by another one. Now into brakes. This is where I try to practice my skills here. That's another 250, ridden fairly well. And I'm having trouble a little bit maybe. Yeah, he's actually fast. Is he faster? Well, I'm about even with him in the corners. But I can't go around them because they're so good, these little guys. And then now we've got to make up. This is the straight into braking zone for corner 3. Gaining ground here. And very tight corner 3 going towards the little kink, which doesn't have a name. It's probably 3.5 right here. This is 4, the fastest corner on the track. Leading into 5. That looks like, oh, that's an R6, an older R6. That's my buddy Dean's old R6, and Dean is a very, very good rider. I would never see this bike. It always rips by me on the straightaway, and I can never reel it in. This guy's, he's just purchased it. He's obviously just getting used to it. So he's kind of going at about 3/4 speed here. And you're going to see something that never happens in a race. I'll get him on the inside, and I can get on the power earlier, and I've got more power down low, but I get the jump on him. Right here in a race is where you would see that R6 go screaming past me. But it doesn't here because I think the new owner is just getting used to it. And I think that around, this is turn 1. I think, yeah, that rider is sitting up and putting his arm out because the practice session's over. And that was cool. So now we're in turn 2 and we're going to exit. Turn 2 right there, and go back to the pits, and try to learn from our experiences on this 15-minute session. Okay, so that was a great day. Now, I don't have any footage of races, because I didn't have a pit crew there, which is me by myself, and so when you're getting ready to go racing, you want to focus on what's important, and what is not important is cameras and videos and that sort of thing. You want to do the best you can, you're in competition, so I do like the way that GoPro picks up the leaning of the bike. It's not a gimbal mount or anything, and if it was mounted on my helmet, you wouldn't see as much leaning of the landscape. I did discover through a couple of pictures that I could be leaning over farther, which we're working on next time. But overall, I'm happy that my lap times during the races were 1 second a lap faster than it was last year. So that's always good. Anyway, that's one of the reasons why I haven't made as many videos recently, is because I've been busy on the weekends. Okay, let's get down to business. All right, in front of the race bike, we have a newly delivered engine that we've had in the shop before. This is an Orenda 10 out of a Canada Sabre. And it's very similar, if you take a quick gander over here, to the Orenda 14 out of a Canadian Sabre. Now the Orenda 14, the difference is it's got a two-stage turbine. These things are a little bit bigger, but the compressor is the same, and the inlet size is the same. So I think the mass airflow is the same. I think it just heats it up more and it extracts more, it puts more fuel in because it can handle higher temperatures because it's using more cooling air. And this engine makes a little bit more, I think about 1,000 pounds more thrust than the Mighty 10. Now, where's a light here? Let me get a light. Here we go. Looking in the back here. This engine had its turbine blades ceramic coated. Oh, they want us to check for cracks. It had its turbine blades ceramic coated back in 2015. It's got a few hours flying on it, and you can see they look beautiful. They're very durable. And the Orenda 14 right over here has only had, 45 minutes of running on its newly coated turbine blades. Very similar look. Yes, it's only got the first stage coated. The second stage are not coated. That's why you're seeing a black set and a white set. It's got a two-stage turbine. So this engine here, the Orenda 10, it's in a very cool video that I made a couple years ago. I think it's called Ready and Running. Anyway, because it's only got a single stage turbine, you only look through the blades and the vanes and you can see a glimpse of the inside of the combustors. And since the ceramic coating doesn't transmit heat very well, it builds up heat as a thermal barrier. That's why it's a thermal barrier coating. Anyway, it's ceramic and it can handle ridiculous temperatures, so it starts to glow red, orange, and yellow. And in the we put a camera looking up the back end of this engine, and it gets to be yellow hot. You can literally see the fire in the combustors past the blades and vanes. It's very cool. Go check it out. I think it's called Ready and Running. Anyway, it's from a couple years ago. So we're going to start working on this engine, do a bit more work. It's had a couple of years of service as an air show demonstrator. And we're going to take care of a few things, freshen it up again. So before we get to that, over the next few weeks, we're going to take on a single topic issue like we have been doing for the past few months. And today we're going to talk about active clearance control, sometimes called active cooling control. I like active clearance control. It's a feature of modern airliner engines and modern high performance engines. Let's get to that right away. Active clearance control. First, I'll give you a quick demonstration with some props that are not jet parts. Then we'll take a look at a book. Okay, so these are two pieces of the same metal, aluminum, and they fit closely together, but there's some clearance. So if, for example, if I hold them straight, they won't jam. If I do this, they'll stick because there's very little clearance. This one, let's say, is the stationary part. This is the rotating part of the engine. So we're going to imagine this is the bladed up disc with the turbine blades in it. So it's not a complete circle of metal. It's a bunch of blade tips, but you get the idea. We could heat this thing up with the propane torch. So it's so hot that I can't hang on to it, and it would not go in. It would not turn. It would stick. And then we could let this cool down to room temperature. We could dip this in liquid nitrogen, and it would not go on because it would shrink. The difference is probably, it's about 20 thousandths of an inch, so a 40th of an inch, so something like a millimeter or less. Aluminum, there's a high degree of coefficient of thermal expansion. So if we put this in here and then we
cooled the outer part down. Actually, hang on a second. I hate to say it, but that was a little too much surf guitar. Okay, so if we cooled this and left this at room temperature, it wouldn't go on. What would happen if we put them together and then cooled the outside? So that the outside would cool faster than the inside and it would stick again. But what if we... There we go. What if we put the whole thing together, soaked it in liquid nitrogen? Well, nothing would change, right? Oh, that's wrong. Because the circumference of the bigger piece is more, there's more metal in it than the circumference of the smaller piece. So even though they're the same metal, the smaller one is gonna shrink by the same percentage as the big one, but a percentage of a big thing is more than a percentage of a smaller thing. So let's say 1% of this is X, 1% of this is 0.98X. So the whole assembly, as you cool the whole assembly, it gets tighter. And I'm sure if we put this whole thing in liquid nitrogen, it would stick together because the outer ring would contract more than the inner and it would stick together. And if we heated both of them up in an oven to, let's say, 400 Fahrenheit, then the clearance would get greater, which doesn't really matter. Doesn't really matter in this thing. Here we go. If the clearance gets greater, it'll still fit. But if the clearance gets greater, if there's more space, around the edges for air to leak through in a turbine engine, you're losing power. With all of those things, now imagine if the cases were made of a different material than the rotating bit. Now you could engineer it so that the cases have a slightly lower coefficient of thermal expansion than the material of the blades, the bladed disc. And so as the whole thing heats up in a uniform temperature, the clearance stays the same and vice versa. But then you're limiting your choices of the metals to coefficient of thermal expansion, which is only one factor whether you want to consider for turbine blades and turbine cases. You want to figure strength, cost, weight, and ease of manufacturing, which goes into cost of the finished piece. All of those things, and probably and also temperature tolerance, loss of strength with temperature increase and vice versa. So I think your most important criteria for jet parts is A, how well they do their job, so strength and resistance to temperature weakening, and then maybe ease of manufacturing, and then maybe cost, and then maybe weight, and somewhere in that mixture we'll put coefficient of thermal expansion, trying to match it up with its working partner as much as possible, but it's not your number one criterion for picking the metal. Okay, after that demonstration of two machined and trimmed, that's right, it's a cam lock fitting, except we've just cut both ends off. And now we use them on our hydraulic press as circular bases to push things into other things. Cool. From the friendly flags to the jet engine, to the French bulldog, to the race bike, to the book. This is one of the books I recommend. This is Aircraft Power Plants by Thomas Wilde and Michael J. Crows, McGraw-Hill. Don't be a wiener and ask me for a link to that book. I just showed you the book. If you need to be spoon-fed, you will not be successful. Please pay attention to this warning. Thank you. Okay, we're gonna go to the to this thing. Now, we're talking about the JT9D7R4, which was a very popular engine in the Boeing 747, yes, for many years. The 7R4 is an old engine, it's been replaced, but it was one of the first that featured, where are we? Turbine cooling, active clearance control. Let's go back and read this. The 7R4 series engine engines employ a modulated turbine case cooling system to improve performance and save fuel during cruise operation. The system starts operating after takeoff and climb,
because during these operations of massive power output, the turbine blade clearance must be greater than it is at cruise. Hang on. Why is that? Because at takeoff and climb out, the engine is near max power, and it's a little margin of safety when your engine is producing 50,000 horsepower at absolute raging max. A little bit more clearance between the turbine blades and the cases, just to make sure they don't touch. Just to make sure. Kind of like, you know, it's like a top fuel dragster run. You want to have everything super happy and not gonna bind or touch or grind in any way. Little margin of safety. So your 747 back in the 80s was making 200,000 horsepower plus on the takeoff, and you don't want anything to touch. So a little bit more clearance, a little bit more. There we go. And now, as we're listening to GTO, here we go. During cruise operation, air flows through cooling ducts around the turbine case, and the resultant cooling shrinks the case to minimize blade tip clearances, thus increasing the turbine's effectiveness and saving fuel. The case cooling system utilized to control blade tip clearance is termed active clearance control. Probably because it controls clearance. It's clearance control, and it's active. So you're pumping cooling air, which might be a couple of hundred degrees Fahrenheit, around a case that is probably 800 or 900 degrees Fahrenheit, to cool it and shrink it down a little bit around the turbine blades, which themselves are cooled. But the, like I said, the whole structure geometrically, the bigger thing is going to expand more than the little thing, so your tip clearance will slightly grow as the temperatures go up, so you can bring it back down. You also need it because you can't design the thing to be manufactured at room temperature and then run at 900 degrees with fine clearances, because as it cools down to ambient, when you shut it off, it'll stick and seize. And then you can't get it started again because it'll just grind itself a new trough, and now your clearance is back to where you need active clearance to shrink it down again. Funny that. Okay, it works in another way we'll look at in a couple of pages right here. Okay, a more modern replacement for the JT90 7R4 is the PW4000, which will be used in more modern airliners. I can't think of it right now because I'm not an aircraft guy, but this is the modern replacement of the JT90 7R4. And so here they talk about, in addition, the PW4000 incorporates an active clearance control, which controls the clearances between the turbine blade tips and the turbine case. Sounds familiar? Clearance control is achieved by impinging cold air from the fan duct on the outside of the turbine case and controlling case dimensions, and resulting in tighter clearances, reduced blade tip losses, and improved fuel efficiency. ACC is used on both HPT and LPT to improve fuel efficiency in the cruise regime. The PW4000's engine's patented thermal compressor rotor, interesting, is designed to provide ACC without impinging cold air on the compressor case. The high-pressure compressor disc is uniformly expanded with hot engine air. This is going to be hot engine air would be, if it's already the high-pressure compressor disc, so compressor discharge air is not hot enough, it must be using some sort of bleed air from the combustion section, I'm not sure, maybe anti-icing air, to reduce rotor to stator seal clearances and thus improve efficiency. Interesting.
So the compressor case is already quite hot at the back. Why would you want to decrease clearances by heating up the compressor rotor versus cooling off the compressor case, just like the active clearance control for the turbine? Why would you do it that way? Well, I can think of one. The active clearance control is like a manifold of tiny pipes that are strung around the outside of the turbine case. It's complicated, it's exposed, it's delicate, and it looks finicky to set up. But the way you would heat up a compressor rotor is just pipe hot air through the middle of it. So less mechanisms and things to set up and possibly get damaged on the outside of the engine, less complicated, simply ducting hot air into the center void
the center space in the shaft or drum that makes up the high pressure compressor. So it's already pretty hot, but you heat it up even more with engine combustion air. I don't know exactly where it comes from, but for example, the J79 anti-icing air comes from a hole in one of these. So it's combustor air. They don't tell you where the source is, and I'm not an expert on the PW4000, but it's interesting that you heat up the small thing on the inside versus cooling down the big thing on the outside. There's both ways have the same effect, just different ways of doing it, and heating the compressor rotor takes less parts and pipes and joints and things like that. So, and it's also not something that's going to be easily damaged by impact, if there is ever an impact, which hopefully there isn't, because it's an airliner engine and it's treated with great care. Great care. We just moved this into the shop yesterday, and we were joking around saying, how do you move a turbojet engine into the shop? The answer, carefully, because they are heavy, they are awkward, they are very delicate, they are very expensive, and they're not really designed to be lifted or moved easily by anybody. They usually have very special fixtures, and we don't have them, so we have to be very careful rigging them to be lifted. You can see our rigging there is not supporting any weight, but the engine's not balanced. You have to lift it from the lifting lug, and then it's tail heavy, so you have to lift with a couple hundred pounds to hold it level and set it into the mounts. So anyway, that's how we do that. Getting off topic here, active clearance control is a feature of, I think, all modern turbine engines, because it's a way of using a very tiny amount of compressor air, an insignificant amount in terms of power, to really improve the efficiency and therefore the power for a given amount of fuel of an engine. So it's one of those things, why wouldn't you? Anyway, that's active clearance control. That was a really good question. And thanks for watching.